My name is Rick Renner, and I'm in Ephesus, sitting in the ruins of what was called the School of Tyrannus. You say, what is the School of Tyrannus? Well, you can read about it in Acts chapter 19. The School of Tyrannus was a small building. It was a lecture hall or a school very close to the synagogue. And the synagogue previously stood behind me where the library now stands. This is the Celsus Library, which was built in the year 110. But previous to that, there was a synagogue there. And in fact, if you look at the facade of the library, someone about 2,000 years ago etched a menorah into the facade of the library to commemorate the fact that once it had been a synagogue. Well, Paul had taught in that synagogue, and once he was finished there and he knew it was time for him to leave the synagogue, the Bible says he left and entered into the School of Tyrannus, and that's where I am. The School of Tyrannus wasn't very far from the synagogue. Paul just went a few steps away to begin the next part of his teaching ministry. And the Bible tells us in Acts chapter 19 that in this very location, can you imagine, right here, the Apostle Paul taught every day of the week, in the mornings and in the afternoons, the Word of God to whoever wanted to hear him. He taught so many people in this location so regularly and so thoroughly that Acts chapter 19 tells us all of Asia, because of that profound teaching ministry, came to know the name of Jesus. It doesn't mean all of Asia was converted, but because of Paul's teaching ministry, they all were informed about Jesus. They came to know about the name of Jesus. And Paul, for 2 years, taught the foundations of faith. He taught Christ from the Old Testament, talked about the anointing, talked about the work of the cross, the power of the resurrection. He put people on a solid foundation because he knew people needed to have a doctrinal foundation for their lives. Do you know doctrine? Do you know what the Bible teaches you? You need to really be established on a strong foundation, because whatever your foundation is, it has to support the rest of your life. And that's what I want to talk to you about today.
Stay tuned for a teaching you can trust, a message that will inspire, strengthen, and equip you with vital insight and understanding from the Word of God. Here's Rick.
I can't even begin to express how much it means to me that you've allowed me to come to you today to teach you the Bible. It's such a great privilege to open the Bible and begin to teach verse by verse, word by word. And we're looking right now at something very important. We're looking at foundations of faith. And this is our third program in that series. In the first program, we looked at what is your spiritual status? Very important. In the second program, we look at what the Bible has to say about repentance. Because in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, the Bible says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrines of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works. Repentance was the first doctrine that is listed in these foundational doctrines in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1. But before we go any further, I want to point out something else in verse 1. It says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrines of Christ. This word leaving really means let's go on. Well, we want to go on. We want to grow. We want to go to higher things and deeper things. But you can't go to the higher and to the deeper things until first you're established in the basics. You have to be able to pass that test first. So I want to ask you, are you established in the basics? And I'm talking particularly about the basics that are listed in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 and 2. These are fundamental to our faith. And if you don't get these right, it is guaranteed that somewhere along the way in the future, you're going to make some kind of wrong spiritual calculation that will radically affect your life in a negative way. So you need to know what the basics are. They affect everything else. Just like the foundation for a building, this is essential for building further in your life. You know, in this part of the world where I live, there's a very large building that has never been occupied because they didn't build the foundation correctly. They were in a hurry, and they wanted to build something big, something tall, and the workers wanted to prove that they could move quicker than anyone else and build something faster than it had ever been built before. And indeed, they built something very big that cannot be occupied because it tilts, it leans. The foundation was not correctly laid to hold that structure. And the same thing happens in people's lives. They want to be deep before they're ready to be deep. They want to be profound before they're ready to be profound. you need to know how to read first. You need to know the ABCs. And I'm just amazed at how many people in the church do not know the ABCs of the Christian faith. For example, what the Bible says about repentance. That's the first doctrine listed in verse 1, and it's called the foundation of repentance from dead works. We saw that that word foundation is the Greek word themelios from the word tithemi, which means to lay, place, or position, and the word lithos, which is the Greek word for stone. But when you compound the two words together, it forms the Greek word themelios, which describes something that is set in stone. And it means when we come to the issue of repentance, this is so crucial in our lives, it should be set in stone. It should be etched in our hearts, something permanent that we understand and that we never have to replicate again. The word repentance, as we saw before, is the Greek word metanoia, from the word meta, which means to change, and the word noia from the word nous, the Greek word for the mind. But when you compound the two words together, it means a change of mind. And my, how important it is that we really understand the doctrine of repentance. Repentance is a decision. It begins your Christian life when you repent of sin. And as long as you serve the Lord will be dealing with you about issues that you need to change in your life, where the Lord will require you to make a decision. That's what the word repent means, to change and to be different. And we saw how important it is that emotions are not required for repentance. There's not a hint of emotion in the word metanoia, the word repent. It simply means to change the mind. If you had to drum up the emotions to change, wow, that could be difficult. But God has given you the power to think. God's given you the power to choose. You can choose to be different, and that's what the word repent means, and that is foundational to our faith. And today, we're going to move to the next subject. In Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, again, the Bible says, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrines of Christ, we saw this word principles, the Greek word arches, it means the starting point. Leaving the starting point, these are the ABCs of the doctrines of Christ, let us go on unto perfection. The word perfection, by the way, is the word teleotes, which describes a student who graduates from one class to the next class. This is a process of education, promotion, education. He says, let's go on. Let's not get stuck at this level. However, you can't go to the next level until you pass the first test. So what is the first test? And we find the elementary doctrines, first of all, are the doctrine of repentance from dead works. And then secondly, and this is our theme today, he mentions faith toward God. Faith toward God is a primary fundamental doctrine of our faith. This is one of the ABCs. Now, it may sound very elementary to you. You say, oh, I understand everything about faith. Faith toward God, what could that mean? Well, in fact, it's very strategic to your faith, and it's not quite as simple as it seems. You have to remember the book of Hebrews was written to Hebrew or Jewish believers. They were saved out of Judaism. And in a life of Judaism, they trusted in all kinds of things for their salvation. They trusted in their circumcision. They trusted in the law, temple sacrifices, temple taxes, traditions, cultures. They trust in all kinds of religious works to obtain salvation. This is what they rested in. This is what they trusted in. But now they've come to Christ. And in Christ, our works do not save us. And so now the writer of Hebrews presents this doctrine, faith toward God. And the Greek actually says, epistos epitheon. From the word pistos, the Greek word faith. But here is the word pistos. It describes faith that is being projected. This is not a static faith that just sits still, but this is a moving faith. It is being projected. It is moving forward. And the Greek says epitheon. The word epi means upon. The word theon is the word God. When you put all of this together, the Greek actually means a faith that is projecting forward, and epi is resting fully, wholly on God and not on anything else. I'm going to use my notes today because I want to make sure I don't miss a single point in this doctrine, which is so very important. This phrase, epistos epitheon, really means a faith projecting upon God, projecting upon Him, leaning upon Him, wholly trusting in Him, not trusting in anything else. It's the picture of complete trust. It depicts no self-reliance whatsoever, but it is a faith that rests only on God and upon epitheon, upon God alone, not trusting in any form of what the Bible here calls dead works, and we'll come back to that in just a moment. Dead works, oh, what a phrase. It describes works that are dead or works that do not need lead to life. And particularly, we're talking about eternal life. We're talking about eternal life. Now, good works are always good for this life. They're healthy right now in a temporal sense. We help other people. It's always good to do good things. But good works do not merit you salvation. If you're trusting in your works, if you're trusting in your deeds, if you're trusting in your outward actions to obtain salvation, my friend, I want to tell you, you're in trouble. You're going to hell. Because people who trust in their good works do not go to heaven. The only way you go to heaven is if you trust in Christ and in Christ's blood alone. And that is why this phrase, faith toward God, epistuos, epitheon, a faith projecting forward and leaning entirely on God alone and on nothing else, is so very vital to your faith. And this is why this is a foundational doctrine. Now, I was raised in a denominational church, and I served for years in a denominational church, and I understand what people think, not only the denominational church, but also in charismatic churches and all kinds of churches. People trust in all kinds of things for their salvation. For example, if you ask people this question, if you died today and went to heaven, why should God let you into heaven? You'll hear all kinds of answers. You'll hear people say, I'm going to read some of the answers that I have personally heard. Well, I've lived a good life. God will let me into heaven because I've lived a good life. I've been sincere. The problem is there are a lot of sincere people that go to hell. I've done nice things for people. I've not hurt anyone. I've given to the poor. I've helped others. I've been a good parent. I've taken care of my elderly parents. I've been a church member. I've been water baptized. I've regularly taken communion. Why, I've even given tithes and offerings to the church. But if you're trusting in any of these things to merit salvation or to find entrance into heaven, my friend, when you die, you're going to have a very sad wake up because you will not go to heaven. Those things will not bring you heaven. They will not open the door to eternal life with the Lord. The only way you go to heaven is if you trust in Christ, as the Greek says here, epistuos, epitheon, a faith projecting forward, resting on God alone, not on any works. And the Bible here calls them dead works. Again, the works are good. It's good that you do them. But if you're trusting in them to save you, they will not save you. In that particular case, they're dead. They're not going to lead you to eternal life. Works simply do not save you. In fact, the Bible tells us very clearly in Ephesians chapter 2, we're not saved by works, and that way no man can boast. We can't boast that we saved ourselves because we were so good in life. The only way you're saved is if you trust in the sacrifice of Christ, if you trust in the blood of Jesus and trust in that blood alone, that is the only way you're ever going to go to heaven. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. Well, this issue of dead works is so serious that in Numbers chapter 9 and verse 10, we have the story where the children of Israel are forbidden to touch a dead body. You got to keep that in mind when you talk about dead works. Dead works, this is something you're not even supposed to touch. You're not supposed to go near to it. You're to have no contact with it, lest you be contaminated by it. And in fact, the Apostle Paul even wrote about this in Colossians chapter 2, verse 21, speaking of dead works, traditions, trusting in works. He says, touch not, taste not, handle not. It's the equivalent of saying, don't even go near it in regard to trusting in your salvation. Don't go near it, don't touch it, don't taste it, don't handle it. And we know from Numbers chapter 9, verse 10, we're not even to touch it. We are not to trust in our works for our salvation. Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 and 2 plainly says we are to have a faith. Number one, a faith that is projecting forward. You've got to release your faith, but not release it in your activities or your actions or your works, but epitheon on God and on God alone and not on anything else. Trusting in Christ's sacrificial death and his precious blood is the only guarantee that you will go to heaven, and it is your guarantee. It is your guarantee. If you trust in anything but Christ's blood, you are in eternal trouble. So what does it mean to trust in Christ and to trust in Christ alone? What does that mean? What does it look like to trust in Christ and only in Christ? Well, let me give you the illustration of the chair that I'm sitting in. When I sat in this chair, I didn't wonder if this chair would hold me. I sat in it and placed all my weight on this chair. In fact, I can even lift my legs. And when I lift my legs, as I'm doing right now, this chair is holding me up. I am fully, completely resting on this chair. I'm trusting in this chair to hold me. And this chair holds me up. I'm resting. I'm putting my trust on it. This is what it means to place your trust on Christ and Christ alone. When I was young, I really struggled with my salvation. I wondered if I was really saved. And the reason that I wondered if I was saved is because every week in church, I heard the message that we needed to be saved. Well, I was saved, but I kept hearing, you need to be saved, you need to be saved, you need to be saved. So I was all the time questioning my salvation. And if I asked Jesus to save me once, I know I asked him 10,000 times. Lord, please save me. Lord, just in case I didn't really mean it the last time I prayed it, this time I'm asking you with all of my heart, as sincerely as I know how, please save me. A couple hours would go by, and once again I'd be doubting my salvation. Oh, such a miserable way to live life. You can't enjoy a life, not an entire full day, because somewhere during the course of the day you're wondering if you're really saved or if you're not saved. If I die, will I really go to heaven? I struggled with this. It was like torture. And then I married my precious wife, Denise, and she was also raised like me, where she constantly heard the question, are you really saved? And Denise also doubted her salvation. So here we were, two people saved, struggling with our salvation. Now we get married. And I'll tell you, even on our honeymoon, Denise and I, rather than enjoying each other, would have moments when we would look at each other and say, are we really saved? We just struggled with our salvation. And over the years, I thought, if I would just ask God sincerely enough, if I could just be pious enough, if I could just prove to God how sincere I was, then God would accept me. But you see, that's kind of a works, me proving something to be saved. This is why people often do good things, because they want it to be on their score sheet for heaven. People trying to do things to merit some kind of favor with God. And in my case, I thought if I could just be sincere enough, then I would be saved. But my friends, I can never be sincere enough to impress God enough to save me. God saves me because of the blood of Jesus and not because of my much asking. And I had to come to a place where I surrendered, where I rested on Christ and Christ alone. And I'll never forget the day that it happened. I was struggling with my salvation, and I walked into an auditorium of a church by myself. No one was there, and I got on my knees. And I said to the Lord, this is it. I'm not asking anymore. I've asked you to save me and asked you to save me. I've probably asked you to save me 10,000 times. And God, I am so tired of asking you to save me. If I'm not saved, there's nothing I can do about it. And in that moment, I rested. I quit struggling. I quit trying to save myself. And just like I'm sitting in this chair, that day I gave up my fight trying to save myself or be good enough to be saved. I gave up, you might say, my dead works of asking and asking and asking, and I simply rested in Christ. And from that day until this day, I have never had a doubt about my salvation. My faith is epitheon. It rests entirely upon Christ, not upon me, not upon my activities, not even on my sincerity. My faith is on His power to save me. And on that fact, I'm at peace and I'm at rest. And that's where God calls us. Well, let's continue. In this scripture, the Bible says that we are to have a faith that rests on Him. Well, in the Old Testament and the New Testament combined, we find why it's so impossible for us to save ourselves. For example, in Romans 5, verse 12, we find that we are born a sinner. We're born sinners. In Psalm 58, verse 3, it says we start sinning the moment we're born. You know why? Because we're born with a sinful nature. You don't have to teach a fish how to swim. They swim by nature. And likewise, you don't have to teach a person how to sin. They sin by nature. And Psalm 58:3 says we start sinning the moment we're born. Romans 3:23 says every person is a sinner. Exodus 34:7, the Bible says God will not clear the guilty. If you're guilty, you're guilty. That's a problem. So Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says, Jesus died for sinners. He came to solve the problem. Ephesians 1, verse 7 says, Jesus' blood was the price that was paid for our redemption, for our salvation. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 says, in the new birth, we receive a brand new nature, a transfusion that changes us. We receive the nature of God. And in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1, which we're looking at today, it describes this faith that I'm describing, resting on God, epitheon, on God alone, and not on anything else. This is foundational to your Christian life. People who trust in something besides Christ, Christ alone, likely are not really saved. Faith in Christ means faith in Christ. Now, when you get saved, you will do good works. And the Bible tells us that in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10. It says, we are a marvelous creation, created in Christ Jesus unto good works. But we don't do good works to get saved. We do good works because we are saved. When we are saved, it's a natural byproduct to want to go to church, to serve others, to give tithes and offerings. It's the byproduct of being saved. It's not what we do to get saved. And in fact, in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 9, it talks about things that accompany salvation. And good works are those things that accompany salvation. When you get saved, you want to do good, you want to do right, but you no longer do it to get saved. You do it now because you are saved. And you ought to do it because you are saved. But our scriptures, Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 and 2, therefore, leaving the principles of the doctrines of Christ, let's go on, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. Now we understand a faith projecting forward and resting entirely, completely, solely upon God and God alone. And then next, the Bible says, and the doctrine of baptisms. That's the next doctrine that is listed. And notice that it's plural, not the doctrine of baptism, the doctrine of baptisms. And according to this verse, there are multiplied forms of baptism in the New Testament. There are three, actually. And that's what we're going to cover in the next program. But my goodness, this foundation series is so important, and we're out of time. But I'll be back in just a moment.
Do you want to lead in life? Lead in your job. Lead your coworkers. You can learn to lead today with Rick Renner's book, Promotion. To be a leader, you don't have to be perfect, but you must be willing to grow. Each chapter, Rick reveals the keys and questions for personal growth, as well as a comprehensive acid test for leadership. In this book, you'll learn the non-negotiable traits that determine if you or someone else is ready to progress in rank, position, or influence, and the practical ways to achieve your desired success. If you are already in leadership, Promotion teaches you the 10 keys every leader must apply to be successful and to build an unbeatable team, and how to mentor promising leaders. This resource is a trusted source of top leadership coaches. And for this limited time, you can get it for just $18. Call now, 1-800-742-5593, or go to renner.org to order.
My name is Joel Renner, coming to you from Moscow, Russia. And I want to say thank you to all of our ministry partners. Your help is helping us change the lives of people all around the world, especially the street kids of Moscow. Moscow is home to over 20 million people, and many children with special needs, but especially children who live on the streets. Because of our partners, we're able to help assist the House of Mercy impact homeless children. House of Mercy is a foster home that has rescued hundreds of children from the streets or from other bad situations and has given them a new chance at life. One of these children is Vita. He was abandoned as a toddler and was raised by dogs until he was rescued by the House of Mercy. Some call this the Mowgli Syndrome, a name taken from the character from the classic Jungle Book story. Because of your gift and the work we are doing at the House of Mercy, Vita is now a healthy child. He is going to school, is being restored after receiving spiritual, emotional, and physical care by the House of Mercy. This is just one story of how the House of Mercy has helped hundreds of children reclaim their lives and fulfill their destinies. This is all possible due to the partners who support our work. Will you consider becoming a partner so that we can continue changing other homeless children's lives like Vita? There are so many more children who need the help of the House of Mercy. Will you show them your care today by giving a gift of any size? When you give, you show the love of Jesus to these precious children. Right now, right from your home, you can help us help others by becoming a partner in this important work. Please call 1-800-742-5593 or go to renner.org to make a donation of any amount. Your financial support is helping us change the lives of children, children just like Vita.
I want to thank you again for taking the time to be with me today, and let me talk to you about faith that rests entirely on God and on God alone. And if you've trusted in anything else for your salvation, take a few moments today to say, Lord, I'm not trusting in anything else anymore. I'm trusting in Christ and Christ's blood alone for my salvation. Jesus says, no man comes unto the Father but by me. That's the only way you go to heaven, is if you have a faith that's projecting forward on God, on Christ's blood, and on Christ's blood alone. And it's such a pleasure that I can talk to you about this foundational doctrine of your faith. But as we close today, I want to remind you about our book, which we're offering, which is called Promotion. The full name of the book is 10 Guidelines to Help You Achieve Your Long-Awaited Promotion. Many people want to be promoted. They want to have a better job, make more money. They want to do better in their vocation. People even want to be promoted in church. Nothing wrong with that. Hey, we all want to do better. We all want to achieve more. God gave us desire to be something and to do something. But how do you know if you're ready for an advancement? Or what do you need to do to qualify for it? You know, God doesn't promote people, even God doesn't, without knowing that they're ready for a promotion. So what changes do you need to make in your life to qualify for a divine promotion? That's why I wrote this book. And I want you to order it, because I believe if you'll really read it, it will make a big difference in your life. Just use the number that's on the screen or our website or write to us, and we'll get it right to you. But I want to pray for you. Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus. We thank you that we trust in the blood of Jesus and the cross of Jesus and in it alone. And we thank you that due to our faith on Christ's blood, we are saved. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for being with me. I'll see you in the next program. And remember Ecclesiastes 8:4, it says, where the word of a king is, there is power.
Thank you for watching this broadcast. For more information on product resources or to learn how you can partner with this ministry, please connect with us at renner.org or call 1-800-742-5593. Also, please be sure to visit us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram.